Buenos días. Y buenos días a la cafetería. Y estamos llegando un poco tarde hoy. ¡Qué suerte! Si podrían dormir un poco tarde. Entonces, si podemos tener un poco de silencio. Podemos comenzar. Mira, este grupo acá enfrente, perfectamente quietos, listos para nuestro día. Y creo que tal vez casi estamos listos todos. Todavía un poco, tal vez estamos listos, casi todavía no. Gracias a mis amigos acá enfrente. Creo que, I think this group in the back needs a little bit more help. Can you give me 5, please, in the back? So you guys know when you give 5, you're ready and quiet. I think I still hear some voices. Perfecto. Ok, podemos levantarnos para jurar fidelidad a la bandera. ¿Quién va a hacerlo en español?
Yo juro fidelidad a la bandera de Estados Unidos de América y a la República que representa una nación bajo Dios, indivisible, por libertad y justicia para todos.
I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Muchas gracias. Please have a seat. Estoy esperando y tengo un cuento fantástico hoy. I know you like, I've got another true story. This is about Melba Liston. Maybe you've heard of her. She was the first woman trombone player to really make it big. And she played with everybody. Everybody wanted Melba Liston to play on their CDs. And at the end, when we're going out, I found a video with one of her songs where she's playing, and I thought that as we were going out, we could hear a little bit of the music to start our, like, what is it, almost a half day of classes that we have today with our 2-hour delay? So let's go ahead and read. This is a Coretta Scott's Coretta Scott King Honor Book. For those of you who know about the Coretta Scott King Award, I think we've talked about it a lot in the library. So this is a biography. It's a picture book biography. It's written by Catherine Russell Brown and illustrated by Frank Morrison. And this is called Little Melba and Her Big Trombone. It is a true story about a real person. Let me see if I can just make myself comfortable here. while we read Little Melba and her big trombone. Spread the word. Little Melba Doretta Liston was something special. The year she was born was 1926. The place was Kansas City, where you could reach out and feel the music. The avenues were lined with jazz clubs, street bands, folks harmonizing on every corner, and all the hot music makers made sure they had a gig in KC. That was Kansas City. From as far back as her memory would go, Melba loved the sounds of music. Blues, jazz, gospel rhythms danced in her head. The plink of a guitar, the hum of a bass, the thrum-thrum of a drum, the ping-pang of a piano, the tremble of a sweet horn. Notes stirred and rhythms bubbled all through Melba's home. She could not get enough. Music was always on her mind. She daydreamed about beats and lyrics. Music was on Melba's mind at night, too, when she should have been fast asleep. And Melba loved to hum along with the radio. Sometimes the music sounded so good, she cupped her ears to the majestic. That was like the big radio back then. She cupped her ears to the majestic and closed her eyes. She especially loved the music of a musician known as Fats Waller, with his growly voice and his booming piano. And the piano, the player piano, came alive when Melba's kinfolk stopped by. When Melba pedaled, her aunties danced around the room. And with all that music flying by, Melba wanted to create her own sounds. When she was 7 years old, she decided to sign up for music class at school. What instrument could I play? Melba wondered. At the traveling music store, Melba eyed a long, funny-looking horn. That one, she cried, it's beautiful. A trombone? Mama Lucille frowned. It's big, and you're a little girl. Melba begged, and Mama Lucille bought that shiny trombone on the spot. She couldn't say no to her only child, and Melba beamed from ear to ear and squeezed her new friend. That night on the porch, Melba listened to Grandpa John play his guitar, and this time she had her own music maker. Grandpa John showed Melba how to cradle the horn, and she tried to push out the slide, but her arm was too short. She had to tilt her head sideways and stretch her right arm. And it sounded bad when she gave a mighty blow. Oy, it sounded like a howling dog. I'm no good, Grandpa, Melba said, tearing up. If you can blow, you can play, Grandpa John said. Now stand up straight and blow steady. So Melba stayed up real late and practiced until she could play a simple tune all by herself. Even with her keen ear, teaching herself to play the trombone was no piece of cake. Melba kept blowing her horn, getting better day by day. The cool brass of the horn felt swell on her fingers. And before long, Melba and her horn were making magic. She was only 8 years old when the local radio station invited her to play solo. And Mama Lucille and Grandpa John were so proud. They watched little Melba play her big trombone. Hard times hit rock bottom in 1937. That's when Melba and her mother moved to Los Angeles in California. The long train ride took them five states west and worlds away from Kansas City. Melba's new teachers discovered that she was as smart as a whip. Her test scores were so high, the principal skipped her up from sixth grade all the way up to eighth. And in high school, Melba joined Alma Hightower's famous after-school music club, and Melba quickly became the superstar in the club's band, the Melodic Dots. The other club members struggled to keep up with Melba, and jealous boys called her bad names. She tried not to care, but way down deep, the names did hurt. But Melba used her horn to turn all those hurt feelings into soulful music. And Melba's talents kept growing. She began writing music too. And then in 1943, when she was 17, Melba was invited to tour the country with a new band led by trumpet player Gerald Wilson. Go meet the world, Mama Lucille said, and she hugged Melba goodbye. You have my blessing. Melba could feel it in her bones. The jazz music scene was calling her name. Traveling with the band was a thrill. Each city, from Salt Lake to New York, was an eye full of something new. And Melba became a master musician. She composed, she arranged music, spinning rhythms, harmonies, melodies into gorgeous tones. And while Melba played the trombone, her bold notes and one-of-a-kind sound mesmerized the crowd. Still, Melba was lonely. She was the only woman in the band, and some of the men were cruel. Others acted like she wasn't even there. But Melba let that music in her head keep her company. And rough times came when Melba traveled down south with singer Billie Holiday and her band. Some white folks didn't show good manners toward folks with brown skin, and hotel rooms were hard to come by. And the band members often had to sleep on the bus. And restaurants didn't always want their business. In the clubs, audiences sometimes sat and stared at the band or didn't even show up at all. Discouraged, Melba almost walked away from her trombone for good. But Melba's fans would not let her quit. By the 1950s, all the cool jazz musicians wanted some Melba magic. Dizzy Gillespie, Duke Ellington, Quincy Jones, and more. They wanted to be on the bandstand with Melba and her divine horn. They wanted to play Melba's music. Melba and her music trotted around the globe, dazzling audiences, making headlines in Europe, the Middle East, and Asia. All her life, Melba kept composing and arranging music, kept making her trombone sing. Spread the word. Melba Doretta Liston was something special. And here we see some pictures of Melba and her horn. She was born in 1926 and died in 1999. And I have a video that I will show you as you go out. You can be listening to a little bit of music from Melba Liston. I hope you all have a fantastic day.